Welcome back to Inclusive Design 24 2022, brought to you in partnership with our Platinum supporters, Intopia and Fable, and Gold supporters, Barrier Break, TPGI, and UX for the Win. You can follow us on Twitter at ID24Conf, and if you have questions for the presenters, which we genuinely hope you do, tweet them using the ID24 hashtag or post them in the YouTube chat that we've enabled for the conference this year. And we will use those in our Q&A at the end of the session. I'm thrilled to be working with Makoto, who is our guest host for this evening. Makoto, over to you.
Thanks, Adrian. I'm Makoto from Tokyo, Japan. Next, we have John Allsopp talking about really inclusive online conferences. Over to you, John.
Thank you, Makoto. I'd like to begin today by acknowledging the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, the traditional custodians of the place from which I am presenting, and a map of whose country, along with other traditional nations in New South Wales, is on screen right now. I pay respect to their elders, past and present, and in the spirit of reconciliation, I acknowledge all Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples at this event and all First Nations peoples, wherever you may be in the world. Today, I'll share some of the lessons we've learned about designing more accessible and including conferences. I guess there's a kind of irony that a lot of what I'll talk about today is how live online conference presentations often have a negative impact on accessibility and inclusion, and how we can address that by often pre-recording presentations. And yet here I am presenting live. Now I must admit, when we first planned to move our conferences online in the wake of COVID, perhaps the single most daunting decision, which was ultimately, as we'll discuss extensively, the best one we made, was whether or not we'd have presenters present live or pre-record their presentations. Now, as I sit here, quite stressed about whether the network will stay up, whether I'll make a mistake or five, and a myriad other factors that could go wrong, when I really should be focusing on the delivery, perhaps this presentation will become the best advertisement for pre-recorded presentations that I advocate. I will, however, record a version using the technologies and techniques I mentioned throughout to give a side-by-side comparison and let you be the judge. I've also tried to minimize the visual aspects of this presentation for reasons I hope will make sense as we go along. A lot of the focus on ID24 this year, as in every year, is accessibility. And today I'll be talking quite a bit about that. But I also want to address some issues more broadly around inclusion and what role design and intentional decision-making can play in making events more inclusive. And this includes things like the language people comfortably speak, socioeconomic status, and where in the world someone might live. Very briefly, mostly for context, my name is John Allsopp. I'm a middle-aged white man of European origin, and my pronouns are he, him. Since 2004, I've been involved in organizing conferences for web designers and developers and all sorts of adjacent areas of professional practice. I've also spoken dozens, if not hundreds of times at events around the world, in person and online. Our programs have always had a considerable focus on assistive technology and ways of designing and developing with accessibility in mind. And we'd always tried to make our events what we believed were as accessible as possible. The pandemic, as with many other things, made us rethink that. Let's start by going back pre-COVID, if that's possible, and thinking about what most people would have considered the essential and indeed sufficient features for an accessible conference. They might have hearing loops, which larger venues generally have and which can be hired. Wheelchair access, depending on where the conference was held in the world, it might be a legal requirement as it is in Australia. But venues here are often far from really wheelchair accessible despite this requirement. Occasionally you might have seen sign language interpreters or very rarely real-time captioning. But none of these really address a fundamental but often overlooked challenge to accessibility that pretty much every presentation has. Presentations are almost entirely strongly driven by visuals, text on slides, graphs, charts, animated GIFs, memes, all things that are inaccessible to people with visual disabilities, as this graph shows. So right now, the screen actually reads this slide left intentionally blank. And the joke is, of course, there is no graph. But if you're a person with a visual disability and you suddenly hear a room full of people laugh at a visual joke like this, although I doubt people actually would, but anyway, and think of how many presentations use this approach of memes and animated GIFs. Or once again, you hear a speaker say something like, as this graph shows, hopefully you can start to get a sense of how much we take for granted as presenters that our audience can see our slides. And of course, we haven't even started to consider disabilities outside hearing and sight. Events, as do almost all spaces outside the home, expect neurodistinct people to enter environments that can be distressing and overwhelming, with no accommodations made that might reduce this stress or aid in the ability for folks to focus on and absorb material. Now, today, for the most part, I'm going to focus on online conferences, but a lot of the considerations that I take into account here also impact accessibility and inclusion for in-person events and presentations as well. Though some of these accommodations may be more challenging or even impossible in that context. As I mentioned, since 2004, I've been running events for web and digital folks, designers, engineers, and product managers. When COVID struck, we knew we'd have to move online, and but we didn't want our online events simply to be placeholders until things went back to normal. We knew online conferences didn't have to, indeed shouldn't, look like traditional conferences just online. We wanted to see this very real and significant challenge also as an opportunity to do conferences better. And a key aspect of this was seeing how online-first events and presentations could focus more on accessibility and inclusion. So today I'd like to talk about some of the things we learned, which, as I mentioned, don't just apply online and which don't only apply to conferences. I then want to zoom in on a couple of specific things we did, some technology we built to make our online conferences more accessible for deaf people and people with visual disabilities, but also we feel benefit all our users. Okay, so it's 2019 again. What does a conference look like? Well, they're probably two or more days back to back. These days are usually really long, often 8 or more hours, and presentations are delivered live from speakers on stage. Then COVID made in-person conferences impossible. For how long? Of course, we realize now we simply had no idea. So we and many other conference organizers did the only thing that was available other than giving up altogether, which many, many did, and we started planning to move our events online. Now, over the last 30 years or so, we've seen so many things from the physical world move online. And there's a really common pattern when this happens. The most immediate example that comes to mind is about web design, which for many years in its early days simply mimicked print design. Perhaps a more pertinent example here is how shopping moved online. Now, online shopping today is commonplace, and it might look like eBay or a shopping website, or more frequently now, something like Shein. But the earliest incarnations were literally malls, shopping malls, only online. Lost in the mists of time is World Avenue, which was a huge play in the 1990s by IBM to essentially create a digital simulacrum of a mall, a shopping mall. They spent more than $100 million on that initiative back when that was actual money. So how did the effort go? Well, you've probably never heard of it. And so monumental a failure was this colossal, hugely hyped at the time effort that a search will yield you almost nothing about World Avenue online. Maybe one or two articles, most of them about when the service got shut down. You'll be hard-pressed, if at all possible, to find a screenshot. It simply vanished. Now, this is a really common thing when we move activities from the physical world online. We start by recreating as closely as possible the real world experience, only online. Something, by the way, most metaverse implementations do right now, which might give us some thoughts about how successful these might be. We saw this when many conferences moved online post-COVID. They were usually two or more days back to back, those really long hours yet again, and typically live presentations from speakers, now on screen instead of on stage. But what we wanted to ask was, what might, indeed, what could a conference look like if it were online first? So let's begin by taking a look at something as straightforward as the format. Long back-to-back days are really limiting factors in so many ways for audiences and for organizers. They limit attendance and so access. With an 8-hour day, you can really only target one time zone effectively. Folks elsewhere need to get up early or stay up late, and allocating long stretches of time over multiple days is hard and exhausting, especially when so much of our work and our lives had moved on screen. So what did we do about that? Well, we simply had shorter sessions, originally around 4 hours, though they ended up even a bit shorter still. And rather than back-to-back days, we originally made 4 successive Fridays, and then later our events got shorter when they were 2 successive Fridays. So we were asking much less in terms of time and attention and effort from our audience, but for a very similar amount of content. We also importantly decided to pre-record all our presentations. As I mentioned at the top, to be honest, of all the decisions we made at the time, this felt like the most risky. Would attendees feel ripped off watching presentations that weren't live? Now, interestingly, only a few days ago, Apple held their first in-person event, announcing all these new iPhones and watches and whatever else for 3 years. While media and others assembled in the Steve Jobs Theater, the entire event was pre-recorded. Now, asking media to fly across the country or the world to attend a pre-recorded presentation, even about new iPhones, is something that I think we can all agree would be unimaginable 3 years ago. But it happened, and you probably don't even know that. One person who noted and talked a bit about it was John Gruber, who has the Apple Watching website called Daring Fireball. And his observations were that these pre-filmed product introductions move faster. The transitions between scenes happen at the speed of energetic cinema. This allows Apple to cover the same amount of information in less time. It allows them to make use of more employees. And it's also a win for would-be presenters who find speaking in front of a live audience too stressful. So ultimately, as I mentioned, this decision to pre-record was the single best decision we made, not least because of the implications for access and inclusion. And now we've been validated by none less than Apple. All right. So let's talk about some of the implications. And we'll start with speakers. As John Gruber observed, many of us will know firsthand that folks often find the idea of speaking in front of an audience really anxiety-inducing. I mean, I'm really experienced it, and this is on screen, and I'm actually feeling quite anxious. So pre-recording may well make it more accessible for such folks to speak. Think too about speakers whose first language isn't that of an event, even when maybe quite proficient in that language. They might find the idea of speaking publicly in a language that's not their first really challenging. Again, pre-recording, the ability to do over, to edit, might really help that. Trust me too, conferences have limited travel budgets, and so the opportunity for speakers to travel to an event and speak are in short supply. And so these slots tend to go to more established speakers, which restricts the opportunity for new and more marginalized first voices to be heard. Speakers from many parts of the world also may be impacted by visa requirements, which may take months to receive, may be arbitrarily withheld, may require you being without a passport for an extended period of time while being processed, and they're not inexpensive. At each event in person that we hold in Australia, we pay thousands of dollars for visas, speakers, to speakers' visas when they come and visit Australia. So all of these factors mean certain voices and viewpoints are far less likely to be heard. Non-English-speaking presenters, people from the global south, people with anxiety disorders, and other neuro-distinct people. But when we moved online, the pre-recorded model provided, what we did was we provided equipment, or we otherwise made it easy with a videographer for speakers to record. And then the opportunity for people whose language, first language wasn't English, lived in countries where they're much less likely to see speakers from, all of that increased enormously. We had numerous speakers whose first language isn't English, and from right across the world, from places like Nigeria, Kenya, Brazil, Argentina, Indonesia, Malaysia, the People's Republic of China, and Palestine. So they're just some of the countries from which we had speakers that we previously had at our in-person events. Briefly, I'll talk about attendees as well. Issues of access can be similar, things like cost of tickets and travel, similar, if more, even not greater, visa challenges, and also, of course, language barriers. Now, when we move online, not all of these are necessarily addressed, at least without thinking more deeply about it. There's some subtle challenges like time zones. An 8-hour long day will fit neatly into essentially one time zone. Anyone outside that time zone, where the conference is being held, at least notionally, might find themselves having to get up very early or stay up late to attend. And that can particularly be a challenge for people with families or other carer responsibilities. But by having, once again, these shorter pre-recorded sessions, we found we could repeat each session multiple times across a day, ultimately three times across the 24-hour period, which meant that more or less wherever someone was in the world, they could attend during work hours. Or if they were early risers or late night types, or these hours suited them better, they could attend them as well. So by rethinking the basic conference format, there can be tremendous wins in terms of inclusion across numerous factors. One last thing before I turn to my main focus today was the issue of equity. So developers in Malaysia earn on average less than 20% of a developer in a weird Western, industrialized, educated, rich and democratic country. And the same goes for developers in many countries around the world. And we wanted to ensure equitable access to our events, and so did quite a bit of research about relative developer salaries around the world. And we found there are more or less three tiers. So there's tier one, like, you know, markets like North America, Western Europe, and Australia. A middle tier of about half that, and then a tier of about a sixth of the top tier. So we priced accordingly, and we used geolocation to price in local currencies adjusted to relative developer earning powers. So what was the impact of all these in terms of attendance? Well, we certainly ended up with attendees from all around the world. It was still weighted more toward the global north, but that may have as much to do with our ability to market globally as anything else. But it was definitely hugely gratifying to see folks from all over the world attending at those events. But what I really want to focus for the most part on today is accessibility. While we're seeing a return to in-person events, and I feel we'll likely see fewer and fewer online conferences that look and feel like conferences in the future, the job that these conferences and presentations have been doing for their audience will definitely continue. And I think we'll continue to see presentations online, as indeed we have for years, often recorded in-person presentations that are then up on YouTube after a conference finishes. So hopefully some of what we've learned and implemented with our online presentations since 2020 might help these presentations become more accessible than they currently are. So let's start there with accessibility or otherwise of online presentations. Increasingly, at least for the deaf and hard of hearing audience, we see accommodations being made even for live presentations like today. A great many presentations end up on YouTube, and auto captioning has been a thing there for quite some time. For organisers, it's quick and free. and it's certainly better than nothing. You're experiencing it right now if you're watching this live. But particularly with specialist topics, we found, and above all for presentations focused on software development, where code is used and referred to a lot, automatic or even non-expert human-created captions comes up very short. Terms of art and code examples are often bafflingly mistranscribed. For speakers with even a moderate accent, including possibly folks like Aussies or who speak very quickly, guilty again, auto captioning is often not particularly accurate. And this is where a pre-recorded approach brought additional benefits in terms of accessibility. Pre-recording gives us time to carefully edit transcripts and captions to ensure, for example, programming language features, terms of art, and less commonly used terms are properly transcribed. While we think of captions as being an accommodation for the deaf and hard of hearing, folks with ADHD and on the autism spectrum talk about the benefits of captioning for being able to focus better, possibly even with a sound turned down to minimize distraction. And we're not all currently in quiet, calm environments with noise-canceling headphones. So captions are an accommodation that benefit not simply deaf and hard of hearing viewers or even just people with disability. But we wanted to go one step further than simply captioning, which is a pretty common everyday thing these days. We also created what we call a live transcript. So on screen right now is a screen recording of our live transcript feature, a block of text shown with the presentation video. What the speaker is saying at the time is highlighted, but several lines before and at times after the current phrase are also visible. A caption is what's being said right at that moment, and once displayed, is no longer available. Our live transcripts provide context. They allow the viewer to glance back and understand the context of what they are listening to right now, or if they were distracted or missed a point, they can quickly catch up. But with what is being said right now highlighted and so easy to return to. Remember, our sessions last for 3 hours or more at times, and concentrating consistently for such a long period of time for anyone is challenging, and perhaps particularly so for some neurodistinct viewers. And we've definitely had viewers call out and praise these transcripts for how they allowed them to do exactly this, to focus better and not lose track during presentations. But I want to go a bit deeper, because as I alluded to earlier, we rarely talk about the really visual nature of a presentation and how inaccessible these can be for folks with visual disability. How much of the information, the context, even the subtlety and humor of a presentation is on a slide? And slides are completely inaccessible. They have no accessibility object model. They are just bits on a screen. Screen readers and other assistive devices can't read them, let alone describe a meme GIF used or the graph that you can see just here. So we decided to try and do something about that. We originally considered audio descriptions, which is where a narrator describes what's on screen, as a solution to this. Audio description is commonly used for film and television and even things like live theater. And so we spoke with some AD experts about the feasibility of using audio descriptions for presentations. But the conclusion we came to with them was that this would be likely very distracting. In essence, an audio description runs as a second audio stream alongside the main audio stream. And it would also be technically really challenging to implement. So we approached this in a different way. We call this accessible slides because it's a really catchy name, right? So we take every slide from every presentation, no matter what format, and we get lots of different formats. And of course, this is another reason why pre-recording is really valuable, because this is basically impossible without a pre-recorded presentation. We mark it up semantically in HTML, so headings and lists and links and so on. And we provide alternative descriptions for purely visual elements like graphs and images and other visual components. We then timestamp these for exactly when that slide appears during the presentation. And then there's an option for you as an attendee of a conference to have these displayed synchronized to the presentation while you watch. So on the screen right now is an example from one of our recent conferences. On the left is the video of the presentation. To the right are our accessible slides. And as a slide appears in the presentation, the HTML version moves into view and is highlighted. This, by the way, is sped up a little bit. So, firstly, how does this help people with visual disability? After all, it's just still text on a screen, and we've identified that was a challenge. Well, the slides are presented in an ARIA Live region. So if you don't know about them, what this means is that screen readers which support live regions can recognize and will read out slides as they appear on the screen. Now, we talked about not opting for audio descriptions because we felt they would be really distracting. So what's the difference here? Well, with audio descriptions, the only control, as we mentioned, was a user can turn on or off the audio descriptions. There's no speed control, no skipping, no choice of voice or volume. But with our ARIA Live region-based approach, the user of a screen reader is in control of all the aspects of how and whether slides are read to them using the assistive technology of their choice, the one they use all the time. So not only that, but all the text, including code examples of the presentation, they're now text on screen that the user can copy and paste. And things like links can be activated. You can click them and go directly to whatever the speaker is referring to. So each inaccessible black box of a slide of a presentation is now essentially a web page. And it's presented to the user exactly when the speaker is speaking about that on screen. So we often talk about how accessibility accommodations are just for the benefit of people with disability, but I think this is actually a really powerful example. And that doesn't stop just when a presentation is live. We make presentations available on demand after a conference, and the slides now serve as a way into the content. You can read through the slides and then jump straight into the starting point of that slide. And similarly with our transcripts, you can read the transcript and jump directly into a point of interest. There's no need to watch the entire presentation. And of course, the entire text of a presentation and all its slides are accessible to search engines. So how do we do it? Well, for the developers in the audience, I'd like to take just a little while to look at how it is done and to show you how straightforward it can be to add this sort of feature to anything that you're building as well. So I mentioned live regions. These are an ARIA feature that are perceivable regions of a web page that are typically updated as a result of an external event when user focus may be elsewhere. Now, since these asynchronous areas are expected to update outside the user's area of focus, assistive technologies such as screen readers have either been unaware of their existence or unable to process them for a user. While live regions are commonly used for things like an alert, which pops up while you're using a web app. So we've taken this technology and we've applied it to slides. On screen now, we have the markup for our accessible slides. There's a div, which has two attributes, ARIA Live with a value of polite and ARIA Atomic with a value of true. Inside this is the text of the slide or the content of the slide. In this case, it's a really simple heading of level 3 with the text SOCOM pop-ups, and then we close the div. And that's it. That's all you need to create an ARIA Live region. We have a little bit of JavaScript that updates the content of this div with the content of each slide at the time that slide appears on the screen. And because we've let assistive devices know that this is a live region, screen readers, for example, will now read out the new text inside the element as it appears. We add the ARIA attribute ARIA Live to make the element a live region. That's it, that's all you need to do. And it has the value of polite in this case to tell the assistive device how assertive or otherwise it should be when reading out the content as it appears. There are three levels, by the way, off, polite, and assertive. The second ARIA attribute we add is atomic, We specifies that the whole of the element's content should be read out when that content changes, not just the changed content. And in this case, we made that choice because each slide is entirely different and every slide is replaced with the next slide as we go. With live regions, screen readers can read out changes to the region. So in our case, the text of a slide when it is updated, all under the control of the user who may choose to turn them on or off, and all these other factors I mentioned that they typically have control in when interacting with a web page using their assistive technology of choice. So briefly, I've got a quick screen recording of what this looks like. So this uses VoiceOver on macOS for reading live regions. You'll also see a utility window which overlays the kind of presentation window that shows the text of the live region and how, as the slide updates, VoiceOver starts reading this new text.
Screenshot of a Lighthouse dashboard with four perfect scores. Matuso at blog building the most inaccessible site possible with a perfect lighthouse. Page size and requests. Page size and requests. Graph showing 685 requests, 4,830 kilobytes in size, with the breakdown of asset type, HTML, CSS, etc.
Right. Now, my instinct, and I'm not a user of screen reader technology, is the value of this might be more for those on-demand videos that you can watch after a live presentation, where the user might pause a video, have the text of a slide read out, and then resume the video. Rather than the value being necessarily with these kind of simultaneous live presentation. But really importantly here, the user is in control of their experience. It's not like an audio description where you can either turn it on and have that description read out over the top of the speaker. All right. So what about its actual use in the real world? Well, we've actually used and refined this system extensively for our own events since 2020, so for over 2 years now. And it's been used for hundreds of presentations at dozens of events that we've hosted. It's also been used by AussieWay, who many of you will know is a very long-running Australian web adaptability initiative. So they used it for their inaugural online conference a couple of years ago, and also been used a couple of times by ACCAP, which is an accessible, inclusive tourism conference here in Australia. So they've held two events so far online over the last couple of years, and they've used our technology. So it's been used in the real world in the context for which it was designed. So while the technology is not yet open sourced, and that's mostly I've been pretty busy the last couple of years, but we've been working with this technology with other organizations, and it's certainly our intention to open source it. And frankly, right now, if you're interested, please get in touch. We'd be really glad to help make that happen with you. So on the screen right now are my email address. I'm john@webdirections.org. And on Twitter, I am John Allsopp. That's JohnAllsopp. If you'd like to see the technology in action, then we have a streaming service that we've developed called Confab, which features coming up on 1,000 presentations from past conferences we've run, as well as from other conference organizations as well. And you can get a free account there, which will give you access to everything that's 2 years or old or older, and many of those presentations, as well as all of our more recent ones, and all the ones we will do in the future, feature the technologies that I've been talking about. So you can jump over there and play around and see it in action. Now, I'm just going to turn to the organizer for a moment. I have some bonus material if we've got time, or alternatively, I can plow on. So I might just do that. We've got a little bit of time up our sleeve. Just a couple more thoughts about, these are more directed toward presenters based on our experiences over the last, well, many years in person and extensively the last couple of years. Whereas I mentioned, we have hosted a couple of dozen conferences and you know, dozens or hundreds of presentations. Okay, so the first one is, I'm really increasingly of the opinion that presentations should have scripts, particularly online presentations. And they're much more preferable to extemporaneous ones, even for really structured presentations. So I've edited the transcripts of hundreds of presentations I personally do that for pretty much every presentation at our conferences. And to be honest, almost every unscripted presentation, and this is going to sound really harsh, is gibberish. It's full of discursions and repetitions and half-finished sentences and halts. And we tend not to notice these when someone's on stage because there's so much more information happening. But when it's a screen-based presentation, I feel it's far more noticeable. And in particular, in the context of inclusion, if we think about someone whose first language isn't that of the presentation, or potentially for neurodistinct people, they might find it much harder to keep track of and understand these sort of discursive presentations that go off on tangents and keep coming back. It's very hard to keep track of, I find. Now, I'm not saying that people should necessarily read every word, but there is a reason why television, even live television, is rarely impromptu. So the speaker notes for ID24 discourage live coding, which gratified me because I actually really strongly agree with that. And I think about it from the perspective, particularly of accessibility. Again, I have edited many transcripts that are live coded, right? And I've sat through many other presentations. And I find they're almost invariably disjointed. They're halting. And the speaker is distracted because they're focusing on the code, right? And things inevitably seem to go wrong. So now the audience is also distracted and focused on what's gone wrong, all right? We also find that on-screen code examples tend to be tiny with live coding because you've got a developer in the development window and typically, we've got quite a bit of code on stage, on screen because we're trying to demonstrate a block of code. But they also entirely rely on people seeing what the presenter is coding. No one's going to tell you every word of a piece of code that they're working on. To be quite honest, I would frankly ban live coding. Except for Leah Varou, who does this as an art form and has worked really extensively on it. But frankly, don't live code. I'm going to say, please, for the sake of the children, don't live code. All right. And I think there's a deeper reason for this. And I think it's got to do with the nature of presentations. I think presentations are really about what and why. They really often don't have time for the how. And live coding is really about the how. Right. So leave the kind of how for workshops and tutorials and where there's more expansive space and focus on what and why when you give a presentation. So I've broken a number of my own rules, except live coding here. And once again, I've done that when it comes to screen recordings, because I've obviously used those here to demonstrate some of the features that we have developed. Adding alternative and descriptive text for images and charts and graphs is obviously essential, but really time consuming. But I've particularly found adding alternative text for screen recording to be really challenging. It's very hard to capture the gist of sometimes 5 minute screen recording showing like a very long, complicated process that relies very much on people seeing what is happening on screen, right? And with a speaker rarely describing in detail what they are demonstrating. So at the very least, when using a screen recording, I would very much describe for the audience what is happening on screen. And hopefully you can see I tried to model that with short screen recordings that very much describe what someone would see on screen. All right. So that wraps up my presentation for today. Please do get in touch. Once again, john@webdirections.org. I'm John Allsopp, JohnAllsopp on Twitter and other socials, but I'm a Twitter person. And as I mentioned, if you'd like to experience the technology, confab.com, the URL is on screens. It's a double F, so confab.com. And that will set up a free account and you'll be able to see a lot of these features in action. All right. If you'd like to use the technology, get in touch with me. If you want to tell me I'm wrong about all this stuff, there's always someone wrong on the internet. There you go. I really want to thank the folks for ID24 for putting together this amazing event. I run, as I mentioned, many events in person and online, and I cannot begin to imagine even attempting an event like this, let alone pulling it off, let alone year after year. So well done to you, and please enjoy the rest of ID24.
Thank you, John. I appreciate the shout out there. I also like how meta this talk was, a talk about accessible presentations at a, you get the gist. Makoto, it's awesome that way. Makoto, have we got questions or feedback?
Yes, we just got a question from Ricky Onsman on the YouTube chat.
I know Ricky well. Hi, Ricky.
Speaking for Aussie Way, I can say we are proud and grateful to lean on Web Directions Conference technology. Highly recommended. Question for John. What feedback have had from speakers with this approach? Have any felt constrained, or is it more liberating for them?
That's a really good question. So I think we've had one or two people say they didn't like the idea of pre-recording, maybe one. And this has added hundreds of people we've approached and who've spoken. I think initially it was an interesting challenge for people. And we tried to do a lot of things. So we provided equipment or got a videographer. We provided all sorts of guides. And we sort of learned as we went. We also took care of all the editing. So we would say to people, just record. Start over a bit if you need to. Like, we tried to basically do the editing and make it as easy as possible for people to do it. So I think for the most part, it's been really well received. Certainly, with the exception of one person saying, look, I just don't feel comfortable doing that. Everyone else has been really positive about it. It's an interesting, I think it's a really interesting and valuable and quite different capability. I think presenting in person on the street, presenting live and then presenting pre-recorded are quite different. I mean, obviously they lean on similar capabilities. And that thing about things like scripting, I think is really important. Like, learning to deliver to a camera is something different than learning to deliver on stage. But I think it's a tremendously valuable capability. So they've been well received. And to be quite honest, I think the value of what we produce has a longer term value, because I think, to be quite honest, sitting and watching like a live presentation, even like this one, afterwards, a presentation from the stage, I think there's kind of a bit of a half-life often with that. Whereas I think something's actually crafted for the screen, which we very much tried to do, my feeling is it will have a longer term value. The content. And then look back at, like, John Gruber observed, like, you can fit more in, you can be very concise and really structured, and I think it delivers a lot of value. We found actually presentations have got shorter, but I don't think they've got less information rich. What we've learned is speakers learn how to deliver more in less time. This is a really long online presentation going half now.
Ooh. And next question is from James Nason. What is missing from web standards, particularly ARIA, which would allow more functionality or more reliable functionality?
Yeah, really good question. You put me on the spot, because I haven't thought that deeply about that specific question. I wonder if it's the standards, or I wonder if it's the assistive technologies themselves I kind of think about the challenge that you essentially get two lots of audio happening simultaneously, which is probably a relatively unusual circumstance. And also the amount of audio, for example, slides are typically pretty information rich, right? Particularly when there's say a slide or a graphic, it just takes quite a bit of text to describe something, right? And so there's something, I think maybe it's more a user experience challenge for, assistive technologies necessarily than standards. But I'd like to give that some more thought, and I'd like to hear what other people might have to say about that as well. I feel like it is a relatively novel use of the technology that we're making here. So it might be pretty early days in thinking about that. But good question. Thank you, Dr. James.
Thank you. I'd like to ask you a question. Once we are done with COVID-19, after the COVID-19 situations, event organizers might try to do the hybrid conference where people can attend in person or virtually, remotely, because some people prefer in-person live events and others prefer to attend conferences on live, remotely. Could you please give some advices for event organizers when they will host the hybrid conferences?
Yeah, really good question, McKenna. And so here's the thing. Like, if you'd asked me this about 6 weeks ago, I would have very strongly said, I think hybrid conferences are the worst of both worlds, because the kinds of content and the kinds of experience an in-person conference are and an online conference are actually quite different. And we've learned a lot over the last couple of years. And what we've found with that in our online conferences, they become more and more focused just on the content. And we experiment with lots of social, asynchronous and synchronous. What we sort of found was this kind of chat running alongside the presentation, where often the speaker would be able to, because it's pre-recorded, the speaker could participate with the, in conversation. That kind of went well. We found the asynchronous, or leave a note, have a chat in the background, that kind of stuff didn't really work. So my thought about this changed a bit in the last few weeks. So we have a big event coming up in Sydney, and this is an event we've run in person since 2004, right? And we very much had this position that, look, we don't think you can do the hybrid well. But then we thought more deeply about how exclusive that is. Like, there are many people who are still not comfortable, they just simply can't. They're immunocompromised. There are all sorts of folks who just are in no position to come to a physical event right now. And also there's other things I talked about, like, people were, around through costs, through remoteness. So we've made a decision relatively recently, in the last few weeks, that we are going to do the event, I guess, streamed and in person. And what we're giving a lot of thought to now is, how can we make each of those experiences the best they possibly can be? And what possibility is there to connect people online and people in person? I think the one place where that can probably happen is, so we have a thing where with presentations, we don't have people stand up with a mic and ask questions at the end. What we do, it's a bit like this, is we have a way people can ask the MC gets a question, and then the MC decides, oh, this is a good question, or these three questions are similar. And so there's this conversation kind of generated out of the audience, but not the very, there's all sorts of inclusion challenges with someone standing on mic. Like, lots of people maybe don't feel comfortable doing that, right? For example. So we found that, we've been doing this for quite some time, and we find it valuable even from that perspective. So our thinking is that the people in the room will use our chat feature, so people in the room watching can chat with the people in the room or people online. So can we build some sort of connection between people online and people in person? So that they feel like they're part of the same conversation, right? So that's something we're exploring right now. So I would say let's explore it, and hopefully, again, the motivation for us is around inclusion and accessibility. Right. And I do have concerns about how long the days are and, all that. But the truth is, I feel like it's better, certainly better than nothing, and better than saying to someone who has concerns about being in person, I'm sorry, you've got no access to anything. I feel like some access is better than none. And that'll be an experiment. And maybe we'll find that actually it doesn't work. But let's see. Really good question. And I try to capture these thoughts and write them in our blog and just share them. And some of them are, some of the things we've learned, obviously, I've shared today. But it's, I definitely like to share this. So if you follow me on LinkedIn or Twitter or look at our blog at Web Directions, I kind of try and publish thinking like that. And I've got something coming up around what we're going to try and achieve with that kind of hybrid event.
Thanks, John. Thanks. Yeah. Domo arigato so much. That's all from me. Over to you, Adrian.
All right. For all of our attendees, if you like this session, smash that YouTube like button, or push it or press it or click it or tap it or shout at it. And don't forget, you can subscribe to youtube.com/inclusivedesign24 to be kept in the loop on our future events. A reminder that ID24 is a respectful community. You can find our code of conduct is on the Inclusive Design 24 website. Inclusive Design 24 is brought to you with thanks to our supporters, Intopia, Fable, Barrier Break, TPGI, UX for the Win, Equal Entry, Infoaxia, Intuit, Law Office of Laney Feingold, Adrian Roselli LLC, and WebAble. Thanks to all of them for helping make this possible. Inclusive Design 24 will be back on the hour with our next session. We will see you then.